Hello students, welcome to the video series of Android user interface development. In this video series, we will explain about the user interface, that how to build or design the UI for Android applications. This is our first video, and in this video we will cover the introduction and installation part. So let us start with the introduction part. Now, about Android technologies, there are some points that we'll have to read one by one. Android provides a rich application framework that allows you to build innovative apps and games for mobile devices in a Java language environment. That means that whatever application you build or design, that will operate on Java. But the UI part will be designed in XML, that is extensible markup language. So that is exactly is part of our course. Now the second point is, it is a smartphone operating system. So not only smartphone operating system, but it is an operating system with for smartwatches, tablets, smart TVs, Android and autos. That means it is used in cars as well. It is an open source platform. Now open source means that you don't need to purchase or buy any kind of license in order to use Android software. It is free of cost. You can download it anywhere. Now the third point is that Android platform is based on Linux kernel. Basically what it means is that every platform, like a software, has a kernel to operate on. So Windows has a kernel, Ubuntu has a kernel, Red Hat has a kernel. So the kernels used in the Android platform are Linux, similar to Ubuntu and Red Hat. So Android is based on a Linux kernel. Now the next point is that it is developed by Google and it was later handed on to OHA. OHA is an open handset alliance. So basically it's a combination of multiple companies and firms who set the standards for operating systems or Android hardware devices, which is then followed by the whole manufacturing community. So that is all about OHA and the important points about Android technology. Now coming on to the next slide. Now here we see the different versions of Android. Now Android operating system has some versions, and whatever the version Google releases, it releases in alphabetical orders. As you can see on the screen, it starts with C, then D, then E, and then F, and so on. Apart from this, Google has the availability of operating systems that started with A and B, but that they were not officially released ever. Those operating systems, the A and the B, were named Alpha and Beta, and both versions were just for testing purposes to see if Android platform can be used with smartphones or not. When these both platforms operating systems worked perfectly in testing phase, then Google decided to launch this official platform as Cupcake. Then Google designed Cupcake operating system, which was released and installed on smartphones. So first Android phone that came in the market with Cupcake operating system. The name of the version was Cupcake and the code was 1.5. After this, Google released many more versions like Donut, Eclair, Froyo, Gingerbread and Honeycomb. If we talk about Honeycomb, Honeycomb was the first version which supported tablets. But before this, all other versions, they did not have any tablet support. Then the Android OS was came up with these ice cream sandwich and jelly bean versions. The jelly bean versions were 4.1, 4.2 and 4.3, and then 4.4 was KitKat. So the next version was Lollipop 5.0.1. So this version has a complete UI revolution when it comes to design of Android platform. So in this version, there were effects like 3D effects and material design concepts and animations that were introduced in this version, which were not there in the older versions. So because of this, Android's look and feel, the application created in Android, their look and feel, they completely changed because of this introduction of these design elements in this Android version. Now the next version was Android 6.0 Marshmallow, and then came 7.0 Nougat. At this time, latest operating system which is available in the market is Nougat only. In this slide, there is a version named Android O. Android O is the version which is currently under development, and it is the latest version which is going to be released now. So after this, we will see the languages that Android is created on. So basically, Android is based on two different languages. One is Java and one is XML. Java is the primary Android development language, while XML is the extensible markup language. Now what does this mean? This means that Java is the language used for Android coding and backend development, while XML is the language used for creating designs and design elements and screens in for Android applications. So this is the basis of Android applications, that it is formed by two different languages. One is Java and one is XML. So this is the primary difference between Java and XML. I'll give you an example to make you understand. So basically, XML is all the screens that we see on an application in the front end are designed using the XML language, and all the data that is fetched from the backend server and all the coding that goes behind those screens, that is created in the Java language. So this is the basis of Android platform, that it is created using two different languages. So now you know what is Android, how many versions were released, and which language we use in Android development. And now in this slide, we will let you know how to set up the Android Studio in Windows. So basically, we are using Windows. We are showing a setup process for Windows because that is a very common platform which is used by mostly 90% of the students out there. And if you have some other platform like Linux or Mac operating system, then let us know and put in a query, and we'll let you know how to install it for either Mac or a Linux operating system. So the first step to download Android Studio is, first we need to have a Java development kit on our system. So Java development kit is a very integral part for running Android Studio onto your system. This is the basis on which the Android Studio will run. So that is why we need to install a JDK framework onto the system. So here in the screenshot, we see Java development kit versions for Linux, Mac, Solaris and Windows. So as we are talking of Windows installation here in this video, we'll tell you about how to install the JDK kit for your Windows 86 version or your 64 version. So if you have a 32-bit system, then we'll follow the Windows x86 download. And if you have your 64-bit version, then you can download the x64-bit exe file from here. So I'll just tell you how can you download this file, or where you need to go in your browser to download this file Java Development Kit from. So let's go to the browser, and you need to type in Google JDK download, and the first link will open up. The first link that opens up, this is the Oracle link, which is the official distributor or creator for Java. So you need to click on this link, and this is the link, this is the page that opens up after clicking that link. So here are two options, Java and NetBeans. So we don't require NetBeans for our working, we just need Java. So once you click on Java, you will get this window where you'll see the JDK versions. So this is where we got that screenshot from in the slide. So we need to follow this table, and firstly you need to accept the license agreement, and once you accept the license agreement, only then you can download the software. So we need to check what kind of bit system your Windows is running on. So if your system is running on a 32-bit system, then you'll have to download the x86 version, and if your Windows is running on a 64-bit system, then you have to download the x64 version here. So it's a normal download and installation procedure like any other software. It's an executable file which will download onto your local hard disk, and you need to just install it accordingly, according to the path that is set by default. So after you have installed this, we'll go back to the slide. So after you install this, you have to basically set the environment variables. So this is important because the environment variables is something that the Android Studio software will detect, and if you don't add the environment variables, then it will not detect that your system has the JDK downloaded. So that is why we need to set the environment variables in for the Java Development Kit. So to set the variables, we need to go to the program file. We need to go to the advanced system settings here in Windows, and then we need to set the path of, we need to copy the path where the Java Development Kit was installed. So if you had chosen the default path, then it would have installed in the C drive program files Java, JDK and bin. And if your system was a 32-bit system, then you'll find it in the program files x86 folder. So the path will be the same, the program files, the program file folder will be x86. So once you go into the complete path, just copy the path and go to the system settings and advanced system settings onto your in your Windows. And once you click on advanced system settings, you need to go to the advanced tab here, and you see the environment variables button here. You need to click this button. A window for environment variables will open up. We need to set the system variables. So we need to give the path. We need to give the path of our JDK in the path section here. So if you just click on select the path section and click on edit, you will see a window which will give you an option of setting your adding your JDK path. So what you need to do is just go to the last set variable value and put a semicolon there and just paste your path in that semicolon, after that semicolon, and once you do that, just click OK and go back. Then that will set your path for the JDK for the Android Studio to pick your JDK from. So now we have the system requirements for installation of Android Studio. So here we are showing you the Windows, Mac and Linux system requirements that you need to have for installation of Android Studio. But we'll discuss the Windows system requirements here in detail because we are showing you the Android Studio setup for Windows system. So the first point is that you need to have Windows 7, 8 or 10 or above, so to support Android Studio. The Android Studio is available for 32-bit or a 64-bit system. Both bit systems are supported. So the second point is that we need to have a 3GB RAM minimum and 8GB RAM recommended for running the Android Studio smoothly. We need a high level of RAM because Android Studio is a heavy software. There are multiple files that run in the background. So if your system is not high on RAM, then it could mean that the performance could be laggy, the software could hang, or there could be other problems while coding. So it's better that you have a high RAM availability in your system. The RAM requirements are the same for Mac and Linux also. So the Mac system requires a 3GB RAM minimum and an 8GB RAM is recommended, and same goes for a Linux system. Now coming on to the third point of availability of disk space. So 2GB of available disk space should be there, which is a minimum requirement, and the recommended is a 4GB of disk space. But what we recommend is that you should have 20 to 25GB disk space at any time available on your system. The reason being that there are so many versions released every year and so many updates come out for Android Studio that it needs a continuous installation of files. So if you have a good amount of disk space available, then there'll be less glitches and less problems while updating your Android Studio. Then the fourth point is that your minimum screen resolution should be 1280 by 800 pixels. So this is the normal screen resolution size for the screens nowadays on laptops and monitors. So this should not be much of an issue on most of the screens. So now coming on to the last point for accelerated emulator. So I'll just explain you that what it is. So this is basically a graphic card availability. So why do we need a graphic card for an Android Studio? We need a graphic card for Android Studio to run our applications using the Android Studio only. So for example, if you don't have, you are creating a code for an application and you don't have an Android device, so what do you do? So you run the application using the Android virtual device. We call it the AVD. So that is how, that is built in the Android Studio itself. So that is why we need a graphics card to run the application using the Android Studio itself. So the next part is to download the Android Studio software. So I'll just tell you the steps that we need to follow to download that. You need to go into Google, go into browser, open Google and write Android Studio download. You'll get these results here. So just go into the second result, which is the developer.android.com, and you will get this page. So on this page, this is the official site from where you can download the Android Studio. So this is the official IDE for Android. So here you can download the Android Studio 2.3.3. That is the version that we are downloading the Android Studio. And this is for Windows. And as you can see that this is approximately 2GB software. So it's a very heavy software. And we are not going to show you the complete process of downloading it, because we already have it installed on our system. So what you can do is you can just download this file, and once you start the installation process, that we'll take up from the slides here. So once you download the software onto your system, and you'll click the installation part, you'll get this window. So this window will open up once you for the setup of the Android Studio. So here you see the welcome to Android Studio setup part. So what you need to do is click next. So once you click next, you will see these components that need to be installed for the Android Studio. So Android Studio itself, the component cannot be unchecked here, because the Android Studio is the basic software that we are installing, and we have a SDK, Android SDK, and that is you can uncheck it, and we have the option of unchecking Android virtual device and performance enhancements, and so but we recommend that all of them should be checked, because we assume that you are installing the Android Studio software for the first time. So here it shows the space required also. It is approximately 3.8 GB, that is around 4 GB. So that is the amount of space required to install all these components for Android Studio. So once you are done with this, you need to click next. So once you click next, it will ask you the paths to install the software. So Android Studio, there are two options here. One is for Android Studio installation location, and one is the Android SDK installation location. So you need to just if you want to change this location, then you can just click on browse and set whatever location that you want on your system. Otherwise, this is the default location that gets picked up, and this is where you can install the Android Studio. So once you are set with the locations, you need to click next, and this screen will open up. This will extract all the files that are required to install the Android SDK software onto your system. This process will take some time onto your system, so just be patient with this. And once you are done with this, once all the files are extracted and everything is installed onto your hard drive, then you will get a welcome window for Android Studio. So this is that window, how that window will look like. So in this video, we have three options. There are many options, but I'll discuss the top three because they are important. The new project is basically for creating a new Android Studio project. So what will happen is that once you click on this, Android Studio will open up a window where you can create your new project. If you have an existing project, some other project that you're working on, or do you have an existing project and then you want to import the project onto this computer in Android Studio, then you can use the import project option. So that will help you importing your existing project into the Android Studio installed on this system. And if you already have some projects that you were working on earlier and you want to open those projects, then you can use the open project option here. So as you can see, that we'll see how the project is created now. So the new project can be created from this side also, that file, new and new project. And once we click it, we have to write down the application name. This is our application name, and as you can see, it is written as my application, and in the project location it is written as my application 2. So the reason is that the project location already has a my application, an application called my application in the project location. So that is why it automatically appends a numeric value of 2 to the project to the application name. So now if you write the My Demo app on application name, you see that project location name is changed. And this is a company domain that we use, which needs to be unique. And the package name is attached with the company domain, and the application name is attached to the package name also. So this is your unique identity of your application for that will be used on the Play Store. Once you submit your application on the Play Store, it needs to be a unique name that you submit on the Play Store. So that is why the package name needs to be unique. After clicking the next button, you'll go to this screen, where you'll see all the options available for your application. So if you want to create an application for a phone or a tablet, you can select the first option. If you are creating an application for a wearable device, then you can select the second option, and so on for TV, Android Auto, Glass. So it depends on what type of application you are creating the for what type of device you are creating the application for. So after selecting the type of device, you need to select the type of SDK that your application will target. So the minimum SDK is the minimum software version that your application will run on. So here it is written, like, the lower API levels target more devices but have fewer features available. So by targeting API 15 and later, your app will run on approximately 97.4% of the devices that are active on the Google Play Store. So this means that if you select this API version, that is API 15, then 97% of the devices will be able to support your application. So if you see the other options here, wearable, TV, and you see the minimum SDK version. So here the minimum SDK version is API 21 Android 5.0 Lollipop. The reason is that the versions that are supported, the minimum versions that are supported by these kind of devices and these kind of applications are Android 5.0 and Lollipop. So that is why it is by default, it is selected like this. So after this, you can click on next button. So once you click on the next button, you will go to this screen where you'll see all types of activity screens. So basically what we need to select is the empty activity screen, because we are going to make a application from scratch. But once you have got some experience, or once you know how to make an application, you can use the other screens. For example, if you want to use a Maps activity screen, then you can use a Google Maps activity screen, which will load the Google Maps activity on the design screen. So you can use the direct Google Maps activity screen here. If you want to use the login activity screen, then you can just use this screen directly here, and then it will create the login activity screen. So, but here in our case, that we will use the empty screen only, because we are starting from scratch. So that is why we have selected the empty screen. And once you do this, after selecting the screen, we click next. After clicking the next button, we need to select the activity name and the layout name. So basically the activity name is something like your screen name, right? So the main activity, we normally use a main activity name, which is like the default name, but this can be edited as well. And you can give the name according to the page that is your screen. So for example, if you have a login page, you can name it as a login activity page, and your layout name will change accordingly to the name of what you've given here. So activity is for Java class and layout is for the design files. So that is why we need to define two names here, and that is why automatically the activity name and layout name are interrelated. So whatever we are going to do is we are going to do in the activity login. The designing part will happen in the activity login page section, and whatever the coding that we are going to do, that will happen in the login activity section. So login activity is for your Java coding, and activity underscore login is for your XML design layouts. So after doing that, you need to click on finish, and this is this processing will go on for some time, and this is like building a project. And after building a project, you'll see a My Demo App application that will run. So this is the view that we'll get once your application that we created completes its processing. So this is the directory structure here, where all the directories and files are loaded, and this is the area where you can see the you can write the code. This is your content area called workspace. This is a Java file and this is the design file. We have two options here, design and text. In design option, we can drag and drop where the view is building. This is the view, and you can drag and drop, and or you can either code your XML with the view here. With the help of XML, you can design your view, and this is a preview window where you can see your designing. So now we'll learn about how to work on Android Studio, what are the features, what are the capabilities of Android Studio. So let's start with the basic. This is the directory structure on the left side. The center side is called the workspace, and for the right side, this is the preview portion. So once we go into the file, we have a lot of options here, like import settings, but we'll just only touch those options that we really need for the Android Studio to work on, and other options we can learn later on once we go on, once you learn about the Android Studio. So let's go into settings. And we have so many options here. This is the default view, Android SDK view, where it tells you about all your SDK information, about where it is installed, how many versions are there, and if they are installed or not. SDK tools kit, here you see the SDK tools kit, here you see the SDK updated sites. So everything regarding the SDK platforms and SDKs you get to see in this window. Then we go to the appearance window, where we can change the theme of the Android Studio. So current theme is the Darkula theme. We have total of three themes. So if you have installed your Android Studio, the by default theme is the IntelliJ theme. So this is the view that you might have seen it. So it is totally upon the user. Whatever the user is comfortable with, you can select the theme. So this is according to the user's comfort. Next thing that is important is the modes. So we have three modes here, which is presentation mode, distraction free mode, and full screen mode. Presentation mode is basically used in normally when we need to code and at the same time give a presentation. So the workspace is focused in this presentation mode, and as you can see, the text size has increased. And if you want to exit, you can exit from again the view and exit option. Then we see the next view, next mode. This is the distraction free mode, where you only get the work screen space and no left and right. And the full screen mode is like this, where everything is hidden and only the workspace is visible. So these are a few options that you can use while working on Android Studio. You can run your sample application here. So if we run the application, you'll see a small word like hello, hello world. So that is like a default code that you can run on your application. So here you can run your application from run app option, and if you click on this window will open up. If you have an Android device, then you can show the connected devices will show here, but as I don't have any Android devices connected to the computer right now, so it is showing none. So if you don't have a device, then you can use emulators. So you can create a new emulator, and there are it's like a basically a virtual device. It's like an Android virtual device that will be similar to the real smartphones, but it will be a little different because it is running on your Android Studio. So here you can create your emulator for TV, wearable device, phone or tablet. So there are various options here. So then you select the device type, the device name. Once you do that, you can click on the next option. You have a list of recommended operating systems here. So you can choose any operating system and click next. And then you can set your AVD name, you can set your orientation, you can set your scale, and there are various options basically for your AVDs. After doing that, you can click finish, which will generate your virtual device, and it will show up in this list. So currently I have this device, Nexus 5X, and if you select this and click OK, you can launch the AVD. Your emulator will run, your application will run inside the emulator. So we'll do that a little later, not for now. So after that, I'll show you the AVD manager. You can create your AVD man. You can see your AVD manager screen. So it's the same screen that we've shown earlier. These are the shortcut options to get into the Android SDK, or you can use the settings option, or you can use the shortcut options here. Now let's talk about the build option. So in the build option, you can clean the project, you can make the changes, or if you have done some changes and it is not showing up, and there are some errors in the simulator, then you can use the clean the project once. And this could happen because there are cache files in the studio, in the software. That is why the new files are not getting loaded. That is why the error is not going from the from the screen. Then you can clean the project. Once, if you want to send someone the application, you can build the application. Once you build the application, it becomes an executable file which you can share with other people. You can send it across with as a email or over Skype, or you can just share it with anyone. And this is how the build gets generated. This is, once it is done, there'll be a pop-up. This will be a show in Explorer pop-up. So this is your APK created, and this you can send to anyone through mail or Skype or any other software. So this is how your APK is generated. This is the VCS, that is called the version control system. Here you can just this is used for bit bucket sharing, or you want to share your code on a repository. So this is where we this is how we share the code through on a repository using the VCS, that is the version control system. So here you can see the options of import into VCS, create a Git repository, or import into a subversion. So there are many other options. So there is a option of share project on GitHub, so that will directly share your code onto GitHub repository. So this will study later, but this was all the topics that we had to cover today in this session. That was the basics of Android, what languages the Android is made up of, what are the various versions of Android, what are the features of Android, and how to install Android, what is JDK, how to set the environment variables, how to download Android Studio, and after downloading Android Studio, how to open up a new project. After opening up a new project, what are the various functions of the Android Studio, how can you change the theme, how can you build a project, and how can you add an emulator or a AVD onto your computer or your Android Studio software. So we have touched the basics in this session. So I hope that you have understood the basics. If there are any questions, you can directly write into us in the query section and we'll respond back. And we'll see you in the next session. Thank you.